Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Nyala karish nunga mort, kayen karek nija buja. We acknowledge the Noongar people as the original custodians of this land. The Lord be with you. My great pleasure to welcome members of the Indian community here today, and especially the Consul General of India. It's wonderful to have you here with us, and other members of your staff. This week prepares for the 75th anniversary next Sunday of the independence of India. And so we are focusing on that theme today, and we hope you'll join us afterwards for the refreshments where we are enjoying some Indian food. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, confident in God's forgiveness. Merciful God,
our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in the newness of life. Through Jesus Christ,
Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Domine, Filii, Unigenite, Jesu Christe.
Domine, Deus,
Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, that we may see in you the fulfillment of all our need, and may turn from every false satisfaction to feed on the true and living bread that you have given us in Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the second book of Samuel. The king ordered Joab and Abishai and Ittai, saying, "Deal gently for my sake with the young man Absalom." And all the people heard when the king gave orders to all the commanders concerning Absalom. So the army went out into the field against Israel, and the battle was fought in the forest of Ephraim. The men of Israel were defeated there by the servants of David, and the slaughter there was great on that day, 20,000 men. The battle spread over the face of all the country, and the forest claimed more victims that day than the sword. Absalom happened to meet the servants of David. Absalom was riding on his mule, and the mule went under the thick branches of a great oak. His head caught fast in the oak, and he was left hanging between heaven and earth, while the mule that was under him went on. Joab said, "I will not waste time like this with you." He took three spears in his hand and thrust them into the heart of Absalom while he was still alive in the oak. Then the Cushite came, and the Cushite said, "Good tidings for my lord the king, for the Lord has vindicated you this day, delivering you from the power of all who rose up against you." The king said to the Cushite, "Is it well with you, the young man Absalom?" The Cushite answered, "May the enemies of my lord the king and all who rise up to do you harm be like that young man." The king was deeply moved and went up to the chamber over the gate and wept. And as he went, he said, "O my son Absalom, my son Absalom. Would I had died instead of you, O Absalom, my son." Hear the word of the Lord.
Lord, hear my voice. reading from the letter of Paul of Ephesians. Ephesians अध्याय 4 में से 25 से 32 आए थे और अध्याय 5 से 1 और 2 आए थे. इस कारण झूठ बोलना छोड़कर हर एक अपने पड़ोसी के से सच बोले, क्योंकि हम आपस में एक दूसरे के अंग हैं. क्रोध तो करो पर पाप मत करो. सूर्य अस्त होने तक तुम्हारा क्रोध न रहे और न शैतान को अवसर दो. चोरी करने वाला फिर चोरी न करे, वरन भले काम करने में अपने हाथों में परिश्रम करे, इसलिए कि जिसे प्रयोजन हो उसे देने को उसके पास कुछ हो. कोई गंदी बात तुम्हारे मुंह से न निकले, पर आवश्यकता के अनुसार वही जो उन्नति के लिए उत्तम हो, ताकि उससे सुनने वाले पर अनुग्रह हो. और परमेश्वर के पवित्र आत्मा को शोकित मत करो, जिससे तुम पर छुटकारे के दिन के लिए छाप दी गई है. सब प्रकार की कड़वाहट और प्रकोप और क्रोध और कलह और निंदा सब वैभाव समेत तुमसे दूर की जाए, और एक दूसरे पर कृपाल और करुणामय हो. और जैसे परमेश्वर ने मसीह में तुम्हारे अपराध क्षमा किए, वैसे ही तुम भी एक दूसरे के अपराध क्षमा करो. इसलिए प्रिय बालकों की नाई परमेश्वर के सदृश बनो और प्रेम में चलो, जैसे मसीह ने तुमसे प्रेम किया और हमारे लिए अपने आप को सुखदायक सुगंध के लिए परमेश्वर के आगे भेंट करने बलिदान किया. इन वचन पर प्रभु आशीष दे.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Then the Jews began to complain about him because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. They were saying, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, I have come down from heaven? Jesus answered them, do not complain among yourselves. No one can come to me unless drawn by the Father who sent me, and I will raise that person up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus
Come, Holy God, come, loving source of our life, come, healing light, come, healing light, source of our life, come, healing light. Amen. Would you be seated? Before I say anything else, I have to acknowledge that anything I know about India, I have learned through my knowledge about cricket. Without doubt, the people of India are the most knowledgeable cricket fans in the world, and probably the most fanatic, even more than the Barmy Army. They are certainly the most numerous fans in the world. The rising standard of Indian international cricket teams has been wonderful to see, especially in the last two decades. India won the Border Gavaskar Trophy for the second time on Australian soil this year, and that test series gave us amazing and exceptional cricket from both sides. The ICC regards this series as the ultimate test match series of all time, apparently, according to its polling results. Kohli's men won on the final day of the final match with just three overs to go, even though the great Kohli had returned to India after the first test in Adelaide for the birth of his first child. But we're remembering India today because this week prepares for the 75th year of Indian independence, and this time next year I hope we'll celebrate the 75th anniversary of the day. And I thank the Consul General of India for joining us here. Nearly 75 years ago, British rule ended in India, and at the same time, Pakistan was created. But what I do know of India is much about the leaders of the Indian independence movement. And I think they have much to teach us, for they influenced liberation and freedom movements around the world. Most famous, of course, is Mahatma Gandhi. Gandhi's example of non-violent protest on a large scale influenced the civil rights movement in the United States, particularly Martin Luther King Jr. King said, "Christ gave us the goals and Mahatma Gandhi the tactics." Many of you will know that Gandhi called his non-violence method Satyagraha, a Sanskrit word meaning truth force or holding to the truth, a political tool that he said refuses to use brute force against the oppressor, a political tool that sought to eliminate antagonisms between oppressor and oppressed and aimed to convert not coerce the oppressor so that love conquers hate. What a contrast to Absalom's attempt to change Israel. It ended in his death, as we heard in that first reading. Gandhi famously said, "If it weren't for Christians, I'd be a Christian." And elsewhere, "I like your Christ, I do not like your Christians. Your Christians are so unlike your Christ." It was Christian Britain imposing colonial rule that was the context, and so one can easily understand why Gandhi had his perspective. He later said that the message of Jesus was not to humiliate and imperialistically rule over other people, considering them inferior or second class or slaves, but that when the hungry are fed and peace comes to our individual and collective life, then Christ is born. Well, such thinking aligns well with the underlying meaning of the reading from John's Gospel we just heard sung to us. At the beginning of the chapter from which that passage comes, Jesus has miraculously fed 5,000 people as a sign that Jesus is the bread of life. The chapter continues developing this idea and what it might mean. And in the portion we heard, there is an allusion to the Hebrew scriptures. When the Israelites were fed in the desert, when the Hebrews were starving in the desert, manna comes down from heaven every morning, and it fed them all, but only for that day. This was free food. They didn't have to work for it, but at the same time, they couldn't keep it or control it or limit it. It couldn't be stored. It was just for that day, or it would turn into maggot-ridden mush if they tried to keep it. This is such a powerful message, a powerful metaphor for the grace of God at work, that the nature of God's love is at the heart of all existence, and it is free. We do not have to work for it, but we also can't control it or keep it or limit it. It's for the needs of the day, and when we seek to control love, it slips from our grasp and it becomes mush. Our love for others, or our love for God, is always sporadic and fickle. God's love is the bread of life. And this is what Jesus is speaking of, that this bread of life can be universally available, present through him, feeding a spiritual hunger we know in Australia only too well. For 60,000 years, the people of this land have lived their lives by a culture that was full of spiritual connection with this place. The materialism and consumerism of Australian life today is in great contrast, for it ignores this spiritual resource, and it seems like we prefer to live in a spiritual desert rather than see the manna of God around us. In Australia today, we are hungry. In some ways, this is in contrast to India. There was a survey of India completed recently by the Pew Research Centre in Washington, D.C. India is the biggest religious marketplace in the world, and what they found is in great contrast to Australia. They found that 97% of people they surveyed believe in God, and 80% are absolutely certain about that belief. Religion remains an important part of people's lives across all religions, and this has not changed despite the increase in living standards and prosperity in India. In Western Europe and here in Australia, increased living standards and prosperous lifestyles are thought to explain reduced religious practice. 30.1% put no religion on the 2016 census form, and that's bound to increase the census this month. But this is not true of India. According to the results of this survey, India see religious tolerance as a central part of who they are as a nation. Across the major religious groups, most people say it is very important to respect all religions to be truly Indian. And tolerance is a religious as well as a civic value. Indians are united in the view that respecting other religions is a very important part of what it means to be a member of their own religious community. These are lessons we can learn in Australia. Despite our wealth in worldwide terms, Australia is still a hungry nation. I often wonder if that's why we pour so much effort into our Olympic Games participation, because we're so hungry for meaning and purpose. While Jesus talks about believing he is the bread of life as important, we have to remember that he only talked about it after he had physically fed the crowds first. The German theologian Helmut Tillich told of a hungry man passing a store with a sign in the window, "We sell bread." He entered the store, put some money on the counter and said, "I would like to buy some bread." The woman behind the counter replied, "We don't sell bread." "The sign in the window says that you do," the hungry man said. The woman explained, "We make signs here, like the one in the window, that says we sell bread." But as Tillich concludes, a hungry man can't eat signs. The people of God need to be more than signs. We need to be feeding people. Gandhi once said, "There are people in the world so hungry that God cannot appear to them except in the form of bread. And another famous Indian once said, "In each of our lives, Jesus comes as the bread of life, to be eaten, to be consumed by us. This is how he loves us." Then Jesus comes in our human life as the hungry one, the other, hoping to be fed with the bread of our life, our hearts, by loving, and our hands, by serving. In loving and serving, we prove that we have been created in the likeness of God, for God is love, and when we love, we are like God. This is what Jesus meant when he said, "Be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect." Now, those are the insights of Mother Teresa. There is much we can do to be feeding hungry people, clothing people out in the cold, or providing shelter. In the pew sheets at the moment, you'll find ways we can support the people who do just that. In a couple of weeks' time, it'll be St. Bartholomew's Day, and the chaplain of St. Bart's will be with us. And they are looking for warm blankets, bedding and socks, as well as the parish of Armidale is also looking for these items. So perhaps an extra effort these next 2 weeks to contribute to their cause. Over the past few months here at the cathedral, we prayed for India as the infections peaked and so many people died. More than 400,000 people, at least those are the ones we know of. Thank God that rate has reduced. We have had a condolences book on display in the cathedral these past months, especially to help those separated from loved ones or fearful for their loved ones, or for those who just felt some empathy with India's plight, a way to express their support and empathy. Prayer brings us together, brings us closer to each other, even when seas separate us. Prayer connects us with the bread of life, with that love that underpins all creation. You might, as you leave communion today, you might want to write in the condolences book, because after communion, we shall have a minute's silence to remember those who've died, and I'll present the Consul General with our condolences book as a sign of that shared humanity which is God's gift to us all. Of course, it may not be bread that we need as a world at the moment, it might be vaccines, but only by our compassion and sense of shared humanity can we hope to overcome this pandemic. So let us give thanks to God this day for the people of India, for their resilience at this time, for the freedom they've enjoyed these past 75 years, and for their witness to religious tolerance and freedom in that time. Come, Holy God, come, loving source of our life, come, healing light. Come, healing light, source of our life. Come, healing light. Amen. Let us together affirm the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the peace of the world, the leaders of the nations, and for all in authority. We pray especially for India in their 75th year of independence. I will say of the Lord, you are my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. God of power and might, we lift our brothers and sisters in India to you. We pray for your protection. We pray for your provision. We pray for the nations of earth to have compassion. When people are in need, you are our refuge. When people are scared, you are our refuge. When people are mourning, you are our refuge. Compassionate God, draw close to those who seek your refuge today. Lord, hear us. We pray for the welfare of your holy church. We pray for Kaya Archbishop and Bishops Jeremy and Kate, and for all clergy and people. We pray for the Dean, the Cathedral clergy and associate clergy, and for Cathedral volunteers, welcomers, stewards and readers. Help us to proclaim the abundance and hospitality of God. Lord, hear us. We pray that we may share with justice the resources of the earth and live in trust and goodwill with one another. We pray for those who suffer hardship and deprivation around the world, that they might be comforted by the presence of God and assisted by human hands. We pray for eyes to see suffering and the compassion, creativity, and energy needed to change it. We pray for the people of New South Wales, Victoria, and Queensland in lockdowns, for all who are suffering with COVID, those in hospital, and those who care for them, and for access to vaccinations. Lord, hear us. We pray for people who are aged and infirmed, bereaved, lonely, and for those who are sick and suffering. Especially we bring before you today Darren, Percy, Willie, Louise, Peter, Miller, Dawn, Rachel, Anthony, Coralie, Marilyn, Jeanette, and all who are on our hearts this morning, and those who are caring for them. May they know the comfort of a loving community and of God's healing presence in their lives. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We praise you, Lord God, for the communion of saints and for the glorious hope of the resurrection to eternal life. We give you thanks for the life of Jim Carter, recently departed, and the years mine for Robert Malone, Doris Simpson, William Mould, Cecil Conroy, Jared Moss, and John O'Connor. Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers. Grant that what we ask in faith, we may by your grace receive through Jesus Christ our Lord.
We are the body of Christ.
Your spirit is with us.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give us thanks and praise.
Thanks and praise, glory and honor be yours at all times in every place. Holy and loving Father, true and living God, you have given us this earth to care for and delight in, and with its bounty you preserve our life. We thank you that you bound yourself to the human race with the promises of a gracious covenant and called us to serve you in love and peace. Above all, we give you thanks for your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ. Born as one of us, he lived our common life and offered his life to you in perfect obedience and trust. By his death he delivered us from sin and brought us new life, and offered his life to you and to one another. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with apostles and prophets, and holy men and women of every age, we proclaim your great and glorious name.
Holy God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and wine, and we pray that we who eat and drink them, in obedience to our Saviour Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, may be partakers of his body and blood, and be made one with him and with each other in peace and love. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, and again giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Therefore we do as our Saviour has commanded, proclaiming his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world.
Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
As we eat and drink this holy sacrament, renew us by your Spirit, that we may be united in the body of your Son and serve you as a royal priesthood in the joy of your eternal kingdom. Receive our praises, Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you in songs of never-ending praise. As our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are confident to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours. Now and forever. Amen. As this broken bread was once many grains, which have been gathered together and made one bread, so may your church be gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, let us take this holy sacrament of the body and blood of Christ in remembrance that he died for us and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you have created all humanity in your image and likeness, and have revealed your plan and purpose in calling us your friends and family. As we have shared this holy meal, inspire our hearts to see every man, woman, and child given the dignity and value which is your purpose and your gift. Most loving God, you send us into the world you love. Give us grace to go thankfully and with courage in the power of your Spirit. Let us keep silence and remember with sorrow those who died in India and throughout the world. Come, holy God, come, loving source of our life, come, healing light. Come, healing light, source of our life, come, healing light.
God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.